Namaskar. The book to be discussed today is Profiles and Letters by K. Natwar Singh, an alumnus of St. Stephen's College, Delhi University, and Corpus Christi College, Cambridge University. He joined the Indian Foreign Service in 1953 and represented permanent mission of India to the United Nations in the 60s. After various prestigious postings abroad, he became Secretary, Ministry of External Affairs. A recipient of Padma Bhushan, he joined politics in 1984 and had various portfolios as Minister of State for Steel, Fertilizers and External Affairs. His other notable assignments were as President, United Nations Conference on Disarmament and Development, and leader of Indian delegation to 42nd General Assembly UN in 1987. We have invited in our studios Shri K. Natwar Singh and Shri J. N. Dikshit to discuss the book for you.
Well, I'm delighted to be here, and I'm very pleased and honored that you should be participating in this conversation with me about this book of mine, Profiles and Letters. Of all the books that I've written, I enjoyed writing this one the most, and it came easily. Most writing doesn't come easily, but this one just flowed, and I finished it in less than 3 months. The provocation of this was that I had mentioned this to one of my publishing friends, that I had a large number of letters from Rajaji, Indira Gandhi, Mountbatten, Vijayalakshmi Pandit, E.M. Foster, R.K. Narayan, also a couple from President Zia-ul-Haq and Han Siu-in and Narad Chaudhary. So she said that you were sitting on a epistolary gold mine, and why didn't you start writing? So I did. And fortunately was able to finish it before the last general elections. The person I knew most intimately of all these in this was Mrs. Indira Gandhi, and then would be Foster, and then would be R.K. Narayan and Han Siu-in. The others I knew, but I didn't know them as well as I did
these three
distinguished people I have mentioned. And naturally each one in her or his own way left an impact on my character, on my approach to life, and also the whatever value system I have. So it was not only a personal pleasure and privilege to know these people, but also to learn a great deal. And the learning was not structured, it just happened. When you sit with people who are far more distinguished than you are, some of it rubs off on you.
Now let me start with two philosophical questions. I have read almost each one of the books you have authored. I notice that your orientation is towards recounting, analyzing, transforming an understanding of individuals who have made an impact on history or contemporary or historical trends. I mean, your biography of Raja Surajmal, your biography of your grandfather-in-law Raja Bhupendra Singh, your book on Foster, and now this. Now, the question I ask is that do you think or do you view the individual as the most determining factor in historical processes? That is the first question. Because the people whom you have chosen, Indira Gandhi, Vijayalakshmi Pandit, Lord Mountbatten, Zia-ul-Haq and Rajgopalachari, is a cross-section of political figures who may not have been totally at the apex, but were profound influences on politics. Similarly, Foster and Siu-in are foreign authors. Raj C. Chaudhary and R.K. Narayan, Indian authors. You have tried to analyze them not in terms of so much their literary work, but their views on contemporary events. And the only curiosity I have is, what was the criteria because of which you got Nargis into this book? So, a very broad question, but to sum up, the yep. individual's role in history and the selection, the criteria of selection.
Well, this debate, great men make circumstances or circumstances make great men, goes on. And if you subscribe to Tolstoy's view of history, then he has no place for great men. He said they don't matter. They don't create circumstances, they are just pawns. Now, there's the other theory propagated by people like Bernard Russell and Isaiah Berlin, that an individual makes difference. He makes events happen. He creates circumstances. And having served so long in the Foreign Service, I suppose my position is somewhere in between. Up to a point, I think you can make circumstances. You can control events. But beyond a point, even the greatest man is unable to control events or give them direction. There are other forces, historical forces, imperceptible but very much there, which affect events. We see this all the time. The Partition of India is a good example. Very, very great people in the Indian freedom movement couldn't control events and the country was partitioned. Now, nobody can say that Mahatma Gandhi didn't influence the lives of millions of people. And my criteria for a great person is, did his or her life change the lives of substantial number of people in a positive manner? All these people did. They certainly had an effect on my life. So, and my meetings with all of them were all accidental. I mean, I got to know Mrs. Gandhi when I was still in school, because her younger aunt, Krishna Hati Singh's son, was in school with me. So I knew her since long before I joined the Foreign Service. And Foster I met again at Cambridge.
Student, yes.
Rajaji, pure accident. He came to New York in 1962.
And Biren Chakravarti could not put him up.
So I was then a bachelor, and I asked if he could stay in my apartment. So I said, most welcome. And I thought he'd forget me. He was 85 years old. But obviously, he didn't think me purely as a tolerable waster of his time. And he continued to correspond with me till his final year. And I was very greatly impressed with his sharp mind, his not edgy austerity, but real genuine austerity. He was a man very, very austere.
Let me ask here a difficult and provocative question. While writing about your personal interaction with these great people, how much of an ego trip was there in terms of your own persona, that you were fortunate enough to get to know these people, projecting yourself through your acquaintance?
Since you are an author yourself, first of all, any piece of writing is an honor for the writer.
Absolutely.
Number two, and any piece of writing is also an ego trip. You think you have something worthwhile to say. You think you might be able to make some impact. And you think that people will read your book. So the ego trip is there. But then the ego trip is part of the totality. I write because I enjoy it. I don't do it for earning a living. And I was very lucky at a very young age to meet Foster. My subject was history. But I was very interested in literature, and he encouraged me. And then he said, do you know R.K. Narayan? I said, don't know them. Well, he introduced me, so I came to India and sought out R.K. Narayan in Mysore in 1955. Similarly, I mean, meeting with Hans Huyen, totally fortuitous,
in a restaurant,
Peking hotel where I couldn't order my breakfast, and I wrote a little chit and said, she's all right, I'll order your breakfast, come and join me. And so it started. I was very young. I was of no consequence to these people. But obviously, they didn't think they were a total waste of time. And all this happened in an age when people wrote letters.
That's right.
Now the telephone, the fax machine, the email, etc., etc.
Communications are staccato and in sound bites.
Yeah, sound bites.
not
so. And then I also had the good sense to preserve these letters.
Now coming to two Indian authors whom you have chosen, they are such a contrast in their orientation, Niraj Chaudhary and R. K. Narayan. Niraj Chaudhary is a bit of a Cassandra like detached Durvasa, Maharshi Durvasa, looking at the Indian scene with a sharply critical eye, full of pride about the Indian identity, but full of sorrow and criticism about all that we are. On the other hand, you have R. K. Narayan like a gentle breeze. In all his writings, there is a great empathy, there is a great understanding, there is a emotive linkage which comes out about his writings about India. You have mentioned the letters from them to you. Why is there no, not even a sort of, what prevented you from making a critical comparison between the two in this book?
R. K. Narayan is on good terms himself with himself. Niraj Chaudhary is not only on not good terms with himself, he is also not good terms with India and the world.
World.
But as a writer, I think the Autobiography of an Unknown Indian is a world-class classic.
Yes, absolutely.
Which will be read 200 years from now. If he had written nothing else,
he would have had a place.
He would have a place in the literature of the 20th century. And he is also, I mean, you know, he is by temperament a cantankerous person. I don't mean any disrespect, but you have to be, you have to try very hard to be friends with him.
Well, let me give you an anecdote. Long ago, when one was a student in Delhi University, he came to address the Historical Society on the Harappan and Mohenjo-daro civilization and links with Mesopotamia. At the end of it, two or three of us went to him. This was the time when we were still living in Bada Hindura. Said some of us would like to
Morigate.
And he said, we said some of us would like to come and call on you, sir. And we were totally bemused. He looked at us and said, normally I don't receive colored people at home.
he received this one. He did. Yeah.
Now coming to, I've touched upon the other gentlemen and ladies whom you have.
You asked about Nargis.
Not Nargis, more than Nargis, Ziaul Haq. I also dealt with him very briefly. You spent most of, you were perhaps the High Commissioner, the longest time with him. Perhaps SK exceeds the time, but yours was the period when there was a lot of controversy. And leaving aside his persona, good public relations, gutsy, and his sort of inner involuted approach to India, was he at all conscious of the fact that an adversary relationship with India beyond a point is futile for Pakistan?
I'm not sure. I think he is in many ways an underrated individual. To have survived 11 years at the top in Pakistan, you know, is not easy, and he did. And he was actually supreme. He was everything: chief marshal, administrator,
chief of staff,
president. Marshal, and president. Everything he was. And the link started because of St. Stephen's College. He was there before my time, but he was very proud of being a Stephenian, and that helped. Yeah. But he was also deep down unforgiving on 1971.
The defeat of 71.
Absolutely unforgiving.
But he was no part of it. He was somewhere.
You know, but still,
he was in
Jodhpur. As a Punjabi, he felt, you know,
intensely about it.
And
therefore, would one be correct in saying that he was totally keen on nuclear weaponization of Pakistan?
It began in his time. It began in his time. I think it was Mr. Bhutto laid the foundation, but it was carried on. 87, 86. He was all out for it. And then on the after the Russians walked into Afghanistan,
of course he got.
He used it maximum to affect us adversely, while maintaining extremely good personal relationship with the Indian ambassador and other Indian visitors. And at times I used to feel that maybe with him at the helm and Mr. Rajiv Gandhi here with a huge majority, we might have sorted out. But it wasn't to be. He died in.
Well, I know Siachen, they had almost come to an agreement. Yes, absolutely.
So he was in supreme control there, Mr. Gandhi control here. we could have had a breakthrough.
I only express the hope at the end of this that despite the limitation which you have just mentioned, now that you have begun with this kind of a book, maybe in the middle of your other political preoccupations, if you have the time, you must break this tradition of atavistic reticence and perhaps
I'll try to do it. Also, I am also at the moment playing with a book called Diplomatic Incidents.
Oh, very
strange, funny thing that happened in our lives.
Why don't you call it Indiscreet Tales of the Indian Foreign?
Yes, possibly. I might even call that.
We do hope that when you write your next book, we will have another chat like this.
Thank you. I'll like to talk to you about your next book.
Thank you.
And the book that we are trying to do ourselves, both of us.
Thank you very much.